promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is
welcome. Here are the upcoming events at MJBC. Join us every Wednesday for Refuel at noon for a time of prayer. See the Refuel schedule on our church website. Join us every Wednesday at 7 p.m. for Wild Service, which is also called Worship on Wednesday. On Sunday, November the 6th, the Music and Arts Ministry will celebrate its anniversary. On Sunday, November the 6th, at 3 p.m., we as a church family will worship with Mount Carmel Baptist Church in Washington, D.C., as they celebrate their third pastoral anniversary of Reverend Dr. Paris L. Smith, Sr. We will honor our Pastor Emeritus, Reverend Eldridge Spearman, on Pastor E Day, November the 13th, 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. services. Our guest proclaimer will be Reverend Lloyd T. McGriff, Senior Pastor of Galilee Baptist Church, Suitland, Maryland. Faith in Action, a community of faith walkers. Join the Naomi Ministry on November the 17th at 7 p.m. on a journey of faith seekers connecting the past to the present to prepare for the future. Check the email blast for the Zoom link. For additional information, contact Reverend Patricia Williamson at patwilliamson@verizon.net. We would like you to stay connected with us by subscribing to our YouTube channel as well as Facebook and Instagram. Let's prepare our hearts for the Mount Jezreel worship experience.
Good evening, Mount Jezreel, and welcome to our Wednesday night WOW service, Worship on Wednesdays. And you that are in the social sanctuary, we welcome you as well. Psalms 150 states, praise the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary, praise him in his mighty heaven, praise him for his mighty works, praise his unequaled greatness. Oh, Father God, we come in the joy of Jesus. We come, Father God, just thanking you for your grace and mercy you have bestowed upon us each and every morning we arose. Father God, we ask that you could bring your spirit into this wild service tonight, Father God. We come anticipating, Father God, a word. We come anticipating praise. We come anticipating prayers, Father God. So, Father God, let your spirit come and reign. In Jesus' name I pray, let us say amen and amen and amen.
I would have fainted, lest I believe to see the goodness of God in the land of the living. You ought to call everybody you know and tell them that your God is undoubtedly and unequivocally awesome. Say, Lord, you are awesome. Everybody say, Lord, yes, you are. Lift your voice and say, you are awesome. Everybody say, Lord, you are awesome. If it wasn't for your love, if it wasn't for your grace, I don't know where I'd be. Hey, if it wasn't for your love, if it wasn't for your grace, I don't know. About it, I say, you are awesome. When I look back over my life, I say, nobody but you, God. Everybody say, Lord, can you testify? If it wasn't for your love, if it wasn't for your grace, no goodness of my own, I don't know where I'd be. Can you lift your hands and say, if it wasn't for your grace, I don't know. Yeah. Say, Lord, If it wasn't for your love, if it wasn't for your grace, I don't know where I'd be. Hallelujah. Somebody wave your hand if you can say, if it wasn't for God's grace, His grace is sufficient. Hey, without you. Now somebody take a moment and just bless His name. If you can think about one or two things that God has done, and call somebody or page them and tell them that He is and forever will be awesome. No more. No more condemnation. Hallelujah. He's already forgiven you. He's already put you back in line. You ought to lift your voice and say, He. You are awesome. You are awesome. Can you tell somebody? You are awesome. God, He is awesome. Ooh, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, You are awesome. You are awesome. Hey, God, You are. You're the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Everybody say, You are awesome. Yes, You are. Yes, You are. Oh, You are awesome. Yeah. Yes, You are.
Good evening, Mount Jezreel Baptist Church worldwide. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Let us go to the throne of grace together. Spirit of the living God, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name this evening. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thank You, Father God, for making a way for us to come to worship You in spirit and in truth this evening. Thank You, Father God, for the roof over our heads, the clothes on our backs, the very breath in our lungs, Father God. But thank You, Father God, for the food on our table. Some semblance of a right mind, enough sense to come to worship You, Father God, collectively through this medium to give You glory, honor, and praise. We thank You, Father God, for our pastor, by Your will, Dr. Jamison Hunter. Bless him, Father God. Bless his family, Father God. Bless his home, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And our pastor emeritus, Reverend Eldridge Spearman, Father God. Bless his home. Bless his wife. Bless his children, Lord, and grandchild. Father God, we ask that You continue to bless our Arise list, and we thank You, Father God, for those who have taken up their bed of affliction and walked. Thank You, Father God, for all that You have done for us according to Your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. We love You, Lord, and we bless You. Have Your way in this service, O Lord. And Father God, we pray and give thanks for the messenger of the word this evening. Use Your preacher in a powerful way, Father God. Speak through them with clarity, power, and might so that it will cause us to understand Your will and Your way for us today. Thank You, Father God, for all the many blessings Thou bestowed upon us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Mount Jezreel is giving time. Let's prepare our heads, hearts, and hands to give to the Lord in this worship experience. Repeat after me. I give because I love God. I give because I trust God. I give because I'm obedient to the word, the will, and the work of God. There are five ways in which we can give. You can give online at mountjezreel.com. You can give by way of bill pay through your banking institution. You can give by way of Givelify. Mail your gifts to the office or drop them off at the church. 420 University Boulevard East, Silver Spring, Maryland, 20901. Everyone, get a $20 seed in your hand as we sow into good ground on this night. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank You for seed and sower, gift and giver. Consecrate them now as we give cheerfully, not out of necessity or grudgingly, because You love cheerful givers. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Come on, let's give unto the Lord.
Come on and clap your hands. If you know without a shadow of a doubt that you're sold out for the Savior, you want to get somebody in and tell them, no matter what happens, no matter what comes, I'm sold out. Clap your hands, everybody. Lift your voice and say, I'm sold out. Hey, hey, my mind, hallelujah. You ought to clap your hands and say, I'm sold out. And my mind, hey, hallelujah. You say, who can separate us from the love of Jesus? Not death, nor life. But how many of you know that he paid the price? Yes, sir. I'm sold out. Hey, you ought to get some pep in your step and say, hallelujah. Nothing can separate me. I am sold. Hey, and my mind. Hey, hallelujah. We say, I've come through the fire and I've come through the rain. But God, he never left my side. He is comforting through. Somebody say, I'm sold out. Hallelujah. In my mind. Hey. Come on, say this. Say, oh. I'm going to keep running this race in my mind. I'm sold out. I'm sold out. Hey. Tell somebody I'm sold out. Hey. Come on, let's say it like this. My heart is fixed. Hey. My mind is made up by it. Hey, God, you've been so good. My mind, no room, no vacancy. I'm all filled up. His spirit leads. Say, lift your voice and say, yeah. Hey, everybody say, my mind, no room, no vacancy. His spirit leads. That's the reason. Clap your hands and say, yeah. You ought to lift your voice and say, hey. I let nothing separate me from the love. You ought to lift your voice and say, yeah. Oh, come on. Say, hey. Hey. Say, yeah. Say yeah, everybody say yeah. Oh, oh, my heart is fixed. My mind, no room, no vacancy. I'm all filled up. His spirit leads. Hey, I'm poured out. Hallelujah.
So good, Lord, you are good. You've been better than good. I can't praise you enough. I owe you my life. I can't praise you enough. Even if I try, 'cause God, you have been so good. God, you have been so good. Yes, you have. So good to me. Come on, lift your voice and say, God, you've been.
You are good.
You've been. God, you've been. You've been better than good. I can't praise you enough. I owe you my life. I can't praise you enough. Even if I tried, 'cause you've been, God, you've been so good to me. Lift your voice and say, Lord, you've You've been so good. When I look back over my life, I can say, you've been better than good. I can't praise you enough. I really owe you my life. I can't praise you. Even if I tried, 'cause you've been, God, you have been so good. Oh, to me. Come on, tell the world, God, you have been. Oh, my Lord. Father, I'm so grateful. Oh, you've been better than good. I can't praise you. I owe you my life. I can't praise you enough. Even if I tried, 'cause you've been. Can anybody say he's been so good? Oh, you've been over and over again. God, you've been so good. Oh, you've been so good to me. Yes, Lord. Come on, we can testify and say this. So many ways you made. All of the times you healed me, you've been better than good to me. So many doors you've opened, God, we're so grateful. All of the times you've been better than good to me. So many ways you made, kept the hand of the enemy from my life. Oh, you've been better than good to me. So many ways you made. All of the times you healed me, God, you've been better than good to me. Oh, God, you've been better than good to me. Morning by morning, brand new mercies I see. You've been better than good to me. For the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. God, I'm glad you look beyond my faults. And you saw my need. Oh, Lord. God, you've been better than good to me. I lift my hands. You've been better than good to me.
The Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me, bless his holy name. How we are so grateful to God to gather on this wow worship experience as we hear from the Word of God on this day. I am excited to join in this worship encounter, and I'm thankful to God for the ministerial team that so faithfully week in and week out shares with us the Word of God. And I appreciate each and every one of them. For the month of November, we're going to journey in a teaching series that I want to title Lessons from the Lectionary. Lessons from the Lectionary. We will commence that series on this afternoon, this evening. So if you have your Bibles, journey with me to 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Second Thessalonians chapter 1. And you will get a hint and some information as it relates to the lectionary as we commence this study. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, I'll read verses 1 through 4, and then I'll pick up and read verses 11 through 12. 1 Thessalonians, reading chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, then I'll pick up verses 11 and 12. Here's how the Word of God reads from the New Living Translation. This letter is from Paul, Silas, and Timothy. We are writing to the church in Thessalonica, to you who belong to God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. May God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. Dear brothers and sisters, we can't help but thank God for you because your faith is flourishing and your love for one another is growing. We proudly tell God's other churches about your endurance and faithfulness and all the persecutions and hardships you are suffering. Verse number 11. So we keep on praying for you, asking our God to enable you to live a life worthy of his call. May he give you the power to accomplish all the good things that your faith prompts you to do. Verse 12, then the name of our Lord Jesus will be honored because of the way you live, and you will be honored along with him. This is all made possible because of the grace of God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, we ask that you opened our eyes and our hearts to see and to sense what you're saying to us. We pray, God, that you will give us insight and inspiration. Encourage us and convict us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today I want to start this conversation, this study, with this thought, enduring faith. Enduring faith. As we journey this series, Lessons from the Lectionary, as a pastor and a believer, I have come to discover that studying from the Lectionary has great value and benefit for life and for living. The scholars who selected these given texts, usually a gospel, an Old Testament passage, a psalm, and an epistle, have taken great measures to give us insight into the history of Christianity, and more specifically, what was going on during the different seasons in the Jewish year. But for me, when I look at the lectionary, what I love about the lectionary is the lectionary breaks the calendar down, liturgically giving insight into the major biblical seasons: Advent, Christmastide, Epiphany, Lent, Easter, Pentecost, and other particular recognized days. But then too, the lectionary also contains a breadth of scripture. The lectionary leads the congregation into a richer encounter with the Word of God through scripture. This affords the reader's appetite to be stretched by encountering passages of the normal readings we typically run to. So the lectionary allows us to engage passages that are not what we consider the normal passages for reading and inspiration. Just like sermons, the lectionary also allows us to preach and teach and even discern what God is saying without force or feeling as if the subject was selected to throw rocks and or to judge someone. So when we look at this, the lectionary, I look at it devotionally each morning. It gives me an opportunity to hear from God in a way where inspiration comes that helps in preparation by way of meditation. So as we look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, a passage that's not as familiar to many, one that some may have read, I paused for a moment as I was going through the lectionary of this week's readings, and this grabbed me. As I read this text, I began to look at this text and to read this text and study this text. And I realized Paul was sending us a text message that I've read before, that he resent again. And I saw something in it that gripped me that I never read the first time that he sent it.
When we look at this passage, here's what I want us to hold on to that I grabbed from this text message that Paul sent. And it's in verse number 4. We proudly tell God's other churches about your endurance and faithfulness and all the persecutions and hardships you are suffering. Here's the thesis that Paul shares, that our faith was designed to endure any persecution and hardships that we might suffer as believers. Our faith was designed to endure any persecution and hardships that we might suffer as believers. And Paul is commending these believers for having what I want to call an enduring faith. So then the question then is asked, what does it take for faith, your faith and my faith, to endure? First, we discover in verse number 3 that a faith that endures is persistent. Write that down. A faith that endures is persistent. Listen to what Paul says in verse 3. Dear brothers and sisters, we can't help but thank God for you because your faith is flourishing and your love for one another is growing. So Paul is sharing with the church at Thessalonica that their faith endures, is persistent. And it persists in spite of problems. That's what he says, because your faith is flourishing. We know that life has its shares of ups and downs, and everything is not always a flowery bed of ease, that we have some contention that we must bump against. We have some mountains we must climb. And Paul says that an enduring faith persists in spite of problems. Songwriter would say it this way: trouble in my way, I have to cry sometimes, but I know Jesus will fix it after a while. We all have problems that we must face. And that's what he's saying, that your faith endures and is persistent in spite of problems. But he also says that your enduring faith is persistent and it should be public and prevalent. I like that. Public and prevalent. That while your faith is seen, it's not to get seen. It's not to be seen. Your faith is a light that cannot be hidden. But while you're going through problems and circumstances and situations, your faith is still being seen. It's still being illuminated. That's why the Bible says, let your light so shine that others will see your good works and glorify God. Our faith is not for us to say, look at me, I'm able to endure this, I was able to survive this. No, your faith is saying, I made it through this by faith because of God. So it should be public and prevalent. But it also should be progressive. That's what he says in verse 4. Verse 4, we proudly tell God's other churches about your endurance and your faithfulness and all the persecutions and hardships you are suffering. That your faith is progressive. It's ever growing. It's for you to be better and not bitter. It's for you to endure the hardships but come out with a testimony, with a faith that says what I went through didn't break me. It built me. I like that. So a faith that endures is persistent. But hold up. A faith that endures requires prayer. I'm down in verse 11. Verse 11, so we keep on praying for you, asking God to enable you to live a life worthy of his call. May he give you the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to do. So faith endures because of prayer. It's going to require prayer. Now, don't miss this, because instinctively believers should pray for themselves. Go on and say to yourself, I got to pray for me. When all else fails, I have to pray for me. I have to pray that God keeps me. I have to pray that God protects me. I have to pray that God watches over me. I have to pray for me. But they also need the prayers of others. That's what he says in verse 11. He's not making it up. So we keep on praying for you. You ought to have some persons who are praying for you. Here it is, because in verse number three, he says, thank you, Holy Ghost, he says that your faith is flourishing and your love for one another is growing. So if your love for one another is growing, that means that we have to be a body. We have to be a church. We have to be disciples that pray for one another. Every time you pray, after you ask God for everything that you need him to do for you, you then have to say, now, God, I need you to bless those who are connected to Mount Jezreel. No, they are not in the same ministry that I'm in. Individual ministry within the church. Yes, they may be more gifted than I am. They may be more vocal than I am. They may have a ministry that's always seen. Whatever it is. But God, I need you to bless them. I'm praying for others just as much as I'm praying for myself. I want God to bless the people on my job just like I want him to bless me. It's cliche-ish, but we can say it, that if God blesses my neighbor, that lets me know he's in the neighborhood. So, God, I need you to bless them. That's where we get that acronym JOY from, Jesus, Others, Yourself. That I'm praying for somebody else. That's why the saints of old would sing that song, and many of us know this song. Somebody prayed for me. They had me on their mind, took the time to pray for me. I'm so glad they prayed. I'm so glad they prayed for me. Then we'll go and be creative. My mother prayed for me. My father prayed for me. My teacher prayed for me. My pastor prayed for me. The deacons prayed for me. The choir prayed for me. We can go on and on. My neighbor prayed for me. Had me on their mind. Took the time to pray for me. I'm so glad they prayed. I'm so glad they prayed for me. They also needed the prayers of others. But it requires prayer to help us endure persecution. That's verse 7. Is in verse number 7. And God will provide rest for you who are being persecuted. When you pray for yourself and you pray for others, it allows God to provide rest. He says, cast your cares on me, for I care for you. Come unto me, all ye who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The fervent and effectual prayers of the righteous availeth much. It requires prayer to help us endure persecution. You cannot get through persecution without praying. Why do you say that, Pastor? Because it gives the believers, here it is, strength. And God will provide rest for you who are being persecuted, and also for us when the Lord Jesus appears from heaven. He will come with his mighty angels and flaming fire, bring judgment on those who do not know God and on those who refuse to obey the good news of the Lord Jesus. They will be punished with eternal destruction, forever separated from the Lord and from his glorious power. When he comes on that day, he will receive glory from his holy people, praise from all who believe. This is when God gives us strength. It's through prayer that we get strength. Through prayer, we get strength. When we bow down and have conversation and prayer with God, we receive strength. And also, to give them power is right here in 11b. May he give you the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to do. This is the power that comes by way of prayer, that we have the faith in all to accomplish all the good things we want to do. I like that. Bless his holy name. But lastly, enduring faith and endures persistent, requires prayer. Enduring faith will result in praise. That's verse 12. Then the name of our Lord Jesus will be honored because of the way you live, and you will be honored along with him. This is all made possible because of the grace of God and the Lord Jesus Christ. The God-lived life will surely honor God. That is how we praise God, by living a life that honors God. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy unto God, for this is your reasonable service. A God-lived life will bring honor to God, that people will see us who live God-lived lives and give God glory for how we live. It puts the spotlight on him. It's what the scriptures teach when it says, and if I be lifted up, I'll draw. When you live a godly life, you are drawing other people to God. You are pointing them in the direction of God. By honoring God, God would also honor you. Then the name of the Lord Jesus will be honored because of you, of the way you live, and you will be honored along with him. In your private moments, take a look at 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 30, where the prophet shows up and speaks to, the prophet shows up and speaks to Aaron about what God had promised them, and told them in verse number 30, I'm gonna read it to you. He tells them that you are going to be honored by God. Shows up, he tells Eli, here's the promise that I have given. I want you to know this is a message from God. And in verse 30, here's what he says. Therefore, the Lord, the God of Israel, says, I promise that your branch of the tribe of Levi would always be my priest, but I will honor those who honor me. When you honor God, God honors you. When you have a love for God, God takes care of you. results in praise, and it's not because we earn it, deserve it, or merit it. That's all in verse 12. In verse 12, he literally is pushing this whole notion that when it comes to the grace that has been given to us, then the name of our Lord Jesus will be honored because of the way you live, and you will be honored along with him. This is all made possible because of the grace. It's not because we earn it, deserve it, or merit it. It's because it's a gift given to us. There's nothing you can do to earn grace. Nothing you can do to deserve grace. We're not that good. We're not that smart. We're not that wise. There's nothing we can do to merit grace. No works you can do for grace. You can't accept grace. It's all because of grace. That's why we can praise God, because it's grace. Grace is God holding back from us what we really deserve. We deserve to die in the persecution. We deserve to be slaughtered in the trouble. We deserve to be overtaken in the storm. But yet, because of grace, our faith is built through the persecution. Our faith is strengthened through the storm. Our faith is growing through the opposition. And it's because of grace, God holding back from us what we really deserve. Grace is God wiping the slate clean and giving us another chance. And that is something we can praise God for. Every opportunity we wake up, we ought to just thank God for grace. We ought to shout about his grace. We ought to praise him for his grace. Because it is what the songwriter said, it is an amazing grace. Why is it amazing grace? Because he looked beyond our faults to see our needs. It's all because of grace. And this is what enduring faith is. So we move through these lessons of the lectionary. That it's, first of all, a faith that endures is persistent. A faith to endure requires prayer. And a faith that endures results in praise. That you and I have the opportunity to celebrate and praise God, bring glory to God, put God on center stage, honor him for all that he's done in our lives to strengthen us, to empower us, and to grow us. And there may be someone who's listening on this night who's saying, Pastor, I need that kind of faith. To have that kind of faith, you got to accept Jesus Christ. Got to believe in the Lord that he died for your sins and confess that he rose from the grave and commit. Dietrich Bonhoeffer says that the life discipleship is God calling us, bidding us to die. That each day we are on an assignment for God, moving unto death. But the good news is that on the other side, there is life when you have Jesus Christ. We want to offer Christ to you, my brother, my sister. We want to ensure that you have a relationship with him. We want to make sure that you are connected and growing by faith in him. So if you're watching us now, a link just went up for you to accept Christ or to join the Church of Christ, a place where we love God and love people, a place where we pray for ourselves, but we pray for others, a place where we worship God for who he is, but we praise God for what he's done, and that's given us grace. So many other things we have reason to thank God for. But the ultimate reason is because of his son, Jesus Christ. And if you fill that digital card out, in 48 hours, we'll contact you. We'll be in touch with you. We'll connect with you so that you will know the next steps of discipleship by way of Mount Jezreel, but also you will begin the equipping stages for your faith development. Because we're all on the journey with growing faith. We praise God for you. We pray for you. And we praise and worship God for what he's going to do through you. How we bless and we thank God for this night, and we give him the thanks and the glory. Look forward to meeting with you next Wednesday. Same bat time, same bat station. As we continue our journey, lessons from the lectionary. Till we meet again, may God bless you and keep you. Let's look to him in prayer. Now may the grace of our God and the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with each and every one of us as we go forward loving God and loving people. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we all say amen. God bless you. God keep you is our prayer.
I've seen you move. You move the...